So I'm Heather McElroy. I'm the Natural Resource Program Manager at the Cape Cod Commission. And I'm joined here this evening by several Cape Cod Commission staff who we'll introduce a little later as we get into breakout sessions, if we get into that. And also Joe Famley from the Woods Hole Group, who's our consultant on this project. Maybe as a starting point, just to, you know, everyone's been on Zoom forever at this point, and I'm sure very familiar, but if you'd like to ask a question, just use the raise hand function under the reactions button, and or you can feel free to enter stuff into the chat, and we'll try to field questions as we go. We have set up the presentation in such a way that we'll pause for questions periodically. We have a first part of the workshop really is a little presentation heavy, but the point here is to get people's feedback. So we want to make sure that people are understanding what we're presenting as we go along. So I'm going to dive in. It looks like we have a number of Town of Yarmouth staff. So thanks so much for you all joining us today, as well as a few others. And really very glad to have others join this evening as well. So this is a project looking at low-lying roads. We are, the Cape Cod Commission is working with 10 towns across the Cape to look at vulnerable roads, and with funding from both the Economic Development Administration and the Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Program. The purpose of our workshop this evening is to give you an overview of some of the flood projections that the Woods Hole Group has developed using a model that Joe Famley will discuss in a little bit, to look at the vulnerable low-lying roads within the town, and to prepare the town to identify key roads that they think they would like to have examined in more depth through this project. So, oh, that's why. Sorry, I'm rusty on this. There we go. So our agenda for this evening is I'm just going to give a short project overview, give you the big picture on what this grant project is all about. Then I'll turn it over to Joe Famley to present the vulnerability and risk assessment, and also to present a little overview of the model that was developed to identify the low-lying roads. And then he'll also present the results of that low-lying roads screening process. And depending on how many folks we have, we'll either have a group discussion or we'll break out into breakout groups in order to have a more interactive back and forth and really hear from the community about what you've heard and the road segments that you think deserves attention sooner than later. And then after that, we'll just wrap up with some next steps for the project. So just to get into this overview, as I noted, this is a project that the commission is undertaking with 10 towns around the Cape with funding from the Economic Development Administration and the Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Program. Through the funding and the work of the Woods Hole Group, who's our consultant on this project, we were able to do vulnerability assessments of low-lying roads and other transportation infrastructure in these communities. We hope to prioritize the vulnerable road segments through this workshop process, and then later the Woods Hole Group, together with another consultant, will develop some potential design solutions for those roads that are identified for that work. We're in the midst of the public process, meeting process with this workshop. We're holding a number of workshops with 6 towns this fall, and then we'll hold similar workshops with the remaining 4 towns later this winter. So just very briefly, I'd like to give just sort of a little overview of what some of the coastal hazards are that we're addressing through this project. Clearly with climate change, we're experiencing much more frequent and much more intense coastal storms. Those storms are bringing with them high winds, waves, rain that result in erosion and flooding. Sea level rise can exacerbate the effects of both erosion and flooding, resulting in areas that were very infrequently flooded now flooding more frequently. And as time progresses, and if climate change projections play out, we will see greater areas inundated due to storm-related flooding. Sea level rise also, which could also be called, you might also hear that described as sunny day flooding, or Joe may refer to it as the extent of mean high water. We'll see sea level rise effects or nuisance flooding in lots of areas across the Cape. And that's part of what will be illustrated through this project as well. Very briefly, because part of the project will result in the identification of some adaptation strategies for the priority road segments that are examined, just to touch on the kinds of strategies that might be considered for a low-lying road. Certainly there are the traditional approaches that might involve some kind of armoring or a gray infrastructure, some kind of traditional engineering approach, bridges even. What we'd also like to examine through this project are green infrastructure approaches or nature-based solutions that might provide the kind of protection that a given road segment could benefit from. It will really depend on the situation, and the project will be looking at sort of the range of possibilities for the road segments that will be examined to give the town a variety of options and costs to consider moving forward with. So our timeline here depends a little bit on the funding source. 6 of our towns are funded under the EDA, under the MVP grant, and then 6 are also funded under the EDA grant. And they're on slightly different timeframes, but Yarmouth is on the quicker timeframe under the EDA grant. The Woods Hole group has already started a lot of this work. They've done earlier this fall, worked on the shoreline projections using their MCFRM, which is the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model. Joe will explain that in a little detail in a few moments. With those flood projections, they then conducted a vulnerability assessment of the roads within the community that might be flooded under different time horizons and projections, flood projections. And then through a process of identifying also the critical road segments based on a set of criteria that we've developed together, we've come up with a set of priority road segments that Joe will present to you in a little bit. All of that has happened up till now in preparation for this workshop. And we'll present that information this evening. Hope to get some feedback from you all. We've developed a tool that we will share with you as well that is another means for collecting information and feedback from the community directly into the tool. And with that information, the town staff will then identify two road segments that they would like to have examined in greater depth. The Woods Hole Group, together with a subcontractor, will work to identify three separate solutions for each of those two road segments, together with some cost estimates for construction of those alternatives for town staff to consider. And that information will then be presented to the community later on this spring or early summer. So that gives sort of a broad overview of our project. And I'll just pause here and see if there are any questions. All right, not seeing any. I'm going to, I'm going to hand it over to Joe to present the next piece of our presentation.
Thanks, Heather. Okay, thank you all for being here. I'm just going to provide an overview of the tools that we're using for this assessment and some of the procedures that we used to develop a vulnerability assessment for roadways in Yarmouth and ultimately arriving at a risk-based screening to help the town and residents and town staff kind of prioritize those segments for further inquiry and design. So the two hazards that we're talking about here are sea level rise and storm surge. Our model relies on the sea level rise projections developed by the state, which are the standard for climate change planning. And I'll just show two examples because Yarmouth has shorelines on both Cape Cod Bay and Nantucket Sound. We use both sets in the model. So these projections are using an updated tidal benchmark. You'll see that black box around 19 years of measured and observed mean sea level elevations. and this is the north grid, the station representing the north part of our model, which is based on the Boston tide gauge. And the second set is for the south, which is based on Woods Hole and Nantucket tide gauges. the numbers that we're using for sea level rise are shown on the flags there. They track on a high scenario, which is in this probabilistic approach. It's a high confidence of not exceeding those thresholds. So, as the climate evolves and different feedback loops initiate, whether it's thermal expansion or ice sheet melt, the numbers that we're using are very high confidence intervals that they, scenarios won't be worse than this. It could be less. So the extra set of marks here on the green line kind of track to a lower scenario where the ice sheet melt might not happen as rapidly or as soon. And so those contributions are less over time. So what you see here, 1.3 feet above this 2008 benchmark for 2030 could also be thought of as a 2050 projection if conditions don't go as fast as projected. The other hazard that we're addressing here is storm surge. And we have a very large data set of coastal storms affecting the region, both tropical, so hurricanes, and extra tropical, such as nor'easters. And we have a large data set of historical storms as well as a synthetic projected set that we've obtained from MIT climate scientists. Both of those things are incorporated into the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model. And that model uses a hydrodynamic and probabilistic approach. The reason that we do these calculations hydrodynamically is because there's a big difference between modeling storm surge in a bathtub versus accounting for all the physical processes that affect water. So what you see on the right here is a map of storm surge at about 12 feet NAVD 88. Using LIDAR, as you'll see in any online sea level rise viewer, just kind of symbolizing the elevation of the land to a certain elevation, and that's your flooding. But what happens in reality is that you have winds and tides and waves pushing water in different directions. So this is the same storm modeled in a hydrodynamic way. It's a nor'easter, so there's winds and waves from the northeast that are pushing water up a little bit higher, especially on the south shore. In addition to accounting for all those physical processes, we're using a probabilistic approach. And the reason that we do that is to help communities plan their and prioritize their investments in adaptation over time. So you might not want to address something that has a 0.1% chance of happening by mid-century, when you have other priorities that have maybe a 20% chance of flooding along that same time horizon. So our flood risk model, as I said, accounts for all of those physical processes that affect water levels. It started as a pilot project for MassDOT in Boston, looking at the central artery tunnel system. It's now been rolled out for use in statewide climate change planning, coastal planning. So the inputs, we have the sea level rise projections that I showed earlier. We have all of those tropical and extratropical storms. there's the elevation of the landscape, as well as roughness coefficients of the land. So water flows more freely over a paved surface than it does a marsh, for example, or a field. So that's accounted for, as well as those changing climate conditions. And so we're running that through the model that's looking at tides and storms, wind, wave setup, run-up and overtopping. And eventually we'll be looking at coastal erosion and how that plays out over time and then further impacts flooding. The primary outputs are flood probability. You'll probably hear me say inundation probability as well. And so that's the chance of flooding, basically water getting, coastal water getting onto a portion of the land during a calendar year. The other primary output that we can develop is flood depth, where we take the water surface elevation at a certain projected probability level and subtract the land elevation so we know how deep that water is. We can dig a little bit further and develop estimates of how long that flood might stay on that part of the land, and look at pathways to try and address key intrusion points. And we can also back out information on wind and waves and currents that help with design criteria and parameters. It's a very highly resolved model. So at each of those intersections in this triangular network here, there's a calculation made for water level across a range of probabilities. So this is an example of the model mesh in Yarmouth. The output, as I said, is primarily these flood probabilities. And so these are the maps for Yarmouth for present day 2030, 2050, and 2070 across all scenarios. The probability levels range from 0.1%, which is that pink, that corresponds to a 1,000-year recurrence interval, all the way up to 100%, which is the dark blue, which is the annual storm. Some of these areas may be tidal in the very dark blue, but the sort of the transparent dark blue is the annual storm. Maybe a point of reference would be the 1% probability level, which is that light green. You could think of that as your future FEMA level. So it's the 100-year storm. So I'll just walk through these maps. This is sort of the basis for our analysis, where you can see the probability will expand in space, and it will increase over time. So there's 2030, 2050. These are pretty big hurricanes that are affecting the South Shore, and 2070. So I'll pause there. And before we move on to going through the process of applying that model to the road network in Yarmouth, and I'll pause there and see if anybody has any questions on the modeling or the projections.
Hi, Joe. This is Eve Zuckoff with WCAI.
Hi.
Hi, I hope it's okay. I know this is a small group. I wouldn't normally ask a question, but it is just directly related to what you were saying. Sometimes when I look at these maps, I have a hard time translating them into English a little bit. Can you show that last map that you were looking at, like 2030? Help me understand it in terms of like, can you say it in a sentence? Like in 2030, there is an X percent chance that X percent of the town will be inundated under these circumstances. Oh, like, is there a way to say it?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have those numbers in front of me, Eve. But basically, if we calculated the area that these different colors were occupying, then we could make that kind of a statement. But I guess one way to think about it, when you're looking at these maps in kind of like a first cut, is that everything that's within the, let's see what's easy to see here, everything that's within the light purple, I don't know if you can see my cursor, but the light purple band is a 10% chance of flooding during a calendar year in the 2030 time horizon. So this pocket here, but it also includes in that 10% storm everything at a higher probability level. So everything from 10% to 100% is flooded in that type of a storm. Whereas at the lower probability levels, those are higher intensity storms. Takes a much bigger storm to get up to some of these reaches. And I'm not sure if that's helping clarify your question.
You know, it really is. And are we talking about thunderstorm, or are we talking about category?
These are coastal storms. This is, it's not precipitation. So these are hurricane driven. So winds and waves driving coastal storm surge up into upland areas, hurricanes or nor'easters.
Okay.
The category, in order to parse out category, it's all sort of rolled into the probabilities. So I think there was a slide that had a bunch of lines for hurricane tracks. Those were a range of hurricane intensities, as well as a range of different nor'easters that have affected the region. And the model just basically runs all of these storms through the landscape and calculates over time the probability of water getting on a certain part of the land, just, you know, running these different storms, you know, hundreds to thousands of times just calculating the statistics on that probability.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Sure. Anyone else?
I don't think I see any hands.
Okay. So the way that we use that information to assess vulnerability of roadways, and I'm using the term vulnerability to describe the probability of inundation or flooding on the road surface, is to compare the water surface elevation projected at different probability levels to the elevation of the roadway itself. So what you see here is a symbolization of the different water surface elevations compared to a cross section that represents a roadway. So on the left-hand side of the screen is in the water. It comes up the beach, and then the road starts kind of where the pink ends. So under present day conditions, this roadway has no chance of flooding. If we advance to 2030 conditions, that water surface elevation and the extent of flooding expands. And so your roadway has a 0.5% chance of flooding along the seaward edge, and then 0.2% and 0.1% at the very end. Still, some parts of that road are not vulnerable to flooding. And then as climate conditions evolve, 2050, the whole roadway is vulnerable to flooding. The probabilities have increased a little bit more. So you're in the 5% to the 1% to 5% range. And then by 2070, those probabilities increase again. So you're in the 10 to 50%. So we're basically extracting an elevation from the road surface and comparing that to our model projections. So that gives us the probability of inundation. The other part of this, in order to get at that risk-based approach, is to use a measure of the importance of the roadway. And so we've worked with a commission to develop this framework to score criticality of all the road segments. And we considered how the road intersects with community and emergency services, that gave it a quarter of its score, how it intersects with vulnerable populations, both environmental justice populations and an assessment of social vulnerability, that was another quarter of the score. Another part was looking at usage and network function. So MassDOT classifies different roadways based on their contribution to the roadway network, whether they're sort of regional interstates or local connectors or just local service roads. And also MassDOT provides data on annual daily traffic averages. So that was another component of the score. And then finally, we looked at economic activity. So the Cape Cod Commission, and part of their regional planning, has developed a layer that looks at business activity in the region and kind of calculates how many businesses are within these areas. So here's sort of a summary of that approach, where we have this risk-based matrix. So vulnerability, criticality, both of those things contribute to risk. So if you have a road segment that is very high probability of flooding, but it's not that important, then it might not rise to the top. Whereas if you have something that's both high probability of flooding, high vulnerability, and also very important, high criticality, then that Those two things multiplied together give you a risk score. And we would prioritize the high-risk roads for adaptation. That pretty much covers the process here that's itemized on the left. I can also stop here and take any questions. That might be good. Okay, hearing none, I'll move on. So we did a couple things to look at the exposure of the roads to flooding. The first thing we looked at was, as Heather mentioned, nuisance flooding, or people sometimes say sunny day flooding. It's the tidal inundation. So where is the where's water coming on average on a daily basis? So using those sea level rise projections, we have developed these mean high water shorelines. So it's an assessment of the extent of the mean high water mark, so the average of the day's high tides. And looking at that compared to Yarmouth's roads, we see that only 6/10 of a mile might be exposed to nuisance flooding under 2030 climate conditions. That expands to 4.3 miles in 2050 and a large portion 23.2 later in the century. And that corresponds to a lot of these low-lying areas on the southern facing shoreline. Going through the assessment of storm-based inundation probability. So these are the summary of the road miles exposed to flooding under each of those probability levels in 2030, where we have up to 52 miles of roadway that could be impacted by a very high intensity but low probability storm. Maybe just to benchmark a 100-year storm, that 1% light green would impact approximately 40 miles of roads in Yarmouth. Under 2050 conditions, that 1% storm could reach about 79 miles of roadway. And later in the century, a 1% storm would be larger and it would impact 90.4 miles of roadway. So as you can see, that the extent of flooding expands over time, as well as the intensity. As I said, the next portion of that assessment was looking at criticality, so the importance of the road segment. And so these are the criticality results for all of those metrics rolled up into a score that ranges from 0 to 100. And the concentration of the higher scores kind of it's kind of intuitive. It follows the Route 28 corridor, as well as a couple along 6A and Route 6 being important for a variety of reasons. So then we take probability of inundation, as I said, and criticality. And we multiply those things together to get an assessment of risk in order to sort those high priority roads and help ultimately make some selections. So these are some maps of that risk ranging from low to high. And we'll dig a little bit further into these a little later on. But you'll see a couple roadways along the southern facing shoreline, Parker's River Bridge or along Route 28. There's an asterisk there because this is a local initiative. And so we're looking at town-owned roads. So while 28 is a state-owned roadway and the town can certainly talk with MassDOT about adaptation, We're concentrating on things that the town has control over. At the same time, privately owned roads are included in this assessment, but again, not put on the list of things that the town can take action on. So other high-risk road segments that came up under the 2030 time horizon were Bayview Street, a group of residential roads near the Parkers River Marshes, Rhode Island Avenue, and Broadway. Another residential area that's west of Inglewood Beach, and finally Prince Road, a neighborhood near Mill Creek. We add Allen Street and Pamet Road as high priority segments under 2050 climate conditions, and another segment of Bayview Street and 28, as well as Old Main Street, Breezy Point, and Willow Street, Mattakees, and Cortland Way later on in the century. And finally, these are the basically a summary table of all of those road segments that we just went through. The 2030 high-risk road segments are outlined in red, excluding Route 28, because it's a state-owned roadway. So what you have here is the road name, a key across the left column, A through N, which will key into the online viewer that we'll step through in a second. An estimate of the potentially affected length of roadway, as well as a description of you know where it is. And then the next two sets of numbers look at the vulnerability. So there's a range of inundation probabilities under the different climate conditions, and then whether or not the road is potentially subject to nuisance flooding. And so if it's blank, it's not subject to nuisance flooding under that climate horizon. And if it is, then we've summed up the length that's potentially exposed. So between risk and probability and nuisance flooding, there may be a variety of ways to look at this this data and this assessment and make decisions on it. But those are the results of our analysis for Yarmouth, and I'll walk through the viewer before we do a breakout. Sorry. So this is the online viewer that Cape Cod Commission developed using these data. I'll kind of run through the features and look at one area so you can kind of get a sense for the different things that you can do. And then we'll walk through the list of roadways that were on the table at the end. So we have a legend here. We also have layers that you can turn on and off. In these two elements, you can make comments. And I think Heather will talk about that in a little more detail later, but looking for community feedback on areas that are also of concern or priorities. We'll turn those off for now. So right now we're looking at the nuisance flooding layer. So we have 2030, 2050, and 2070 from dark blue to light blue. And then I think what I'll do is zoom in to this area here. This particular area doesn't have a whole lot of exposure for nuisance flooding. It's sufficiently elevated, but it does have some storm surge exposure. So looking at criticality, we see this 28 corridor as well as Long Pond Road and some of the other associated roads have a higher criticality. That's informed by all of these layers that you can turn on and investigate. So here's social vulnerability scores, which you can get a sense for how those vary in different places. We have an environmental justice area mapped here. This one is mapped for income. It's part of a dense business activity layer. So these different reds correspond to dense, patchy, sparse businesses. This area also contains a bus route. We can get a sense of how much traffic goes through this area by clicking on these segments and getting a sense of the annual average for daily traffic. So these are well-traversed roadways. And the type of roadway, Route 28, is a minor arterial or urban principal, whereas some of these side roads are local. And then we also have a map of the emergency and community services that fed into that criticality score. So all of those things, and you can click on each of them and see what they are. Police barracks, town hall in this case, as well as ESU. So we have criticality, all of those important community functions played into this high criticality score. And then we start looking at the inundation probability. So again, this is the water surface elevation from the model compared to the road elevation. If the water is higher than the road, then it's flooded. So in this area, there's a small segment on 28 and Old Main Street that has a 1 to 2% chance of flooding. If you walk out to 2050, that probability gets higher. So now we're at a 10 to 20% chance of flooding along this area. And then 2070, that area of 10 to 20% flooding expands, and surrounding roadways also have a higher chance of flooding now. So then we take the probability and the criticality and we get risk. So if you'll recall, the flood probability in 2030 was limited to this area here. So when we turn on risk, we have no risk outside of that area and some low scores, but still, you know, still significant for this in the context of the rest of the town. 2050, that flood risk expands and starts to get a little higher, especially in this area. And then 2070, again, it expands and we're seeing higher scores again, especially down here where the flood probability is higher. That all contributes to our list of priority or high risk roadways. which was presented in that table, and then we can step through using this bookmark tab here. So all of those segments correspond to these links here, A through N. So if we zoom in to this part, segment A corresponds to a stretch of Route 28 by the Parkers River. B is Bayview Street Beach. I think what I'll do is turn on a different base map to give people a little more context. So this segment of Bayview Street Beach Road. C is this area by the Parkers River Marshes. So that includes it was Iroquois, Nauset, Niagara, Pawnee, and Sioux. Apologize for the misspelling there. D is Broadway and this portion of Rhode Island Ave. E, right next to that area, these three road segments, Barrie, New Hampshire, Shore, and also Vermont Ave. And that's next to Englewood Beach. Prince Road, so a low-lying connector to a neighborhood on Mill Creek. Segment G, Allen Street, which is right on the Bass River by a boat yard bridge. H is Pamet Road. So also along the Parker River Marshes. I is Bayview Street, right here near the Barnstable Line. J is another segment of Route 28. Looks like it's a crossing near a tidal crossing at the top of Mill Creek. K is that area that we were just looking at. So a small segment of Old Main Road, but as we saw when we were looking at the probability that exposure expands, you know, further down, up and down Old Main Street. This is just where the highest risk scores came up. L is Willow Street and Breezy Point. So looks like the top of this marsh here, potentially flooding. M is Mattakees Road. Low-lying segment here near the Parkers River Marshes as well. And finally, Cortland Way, over by the old drive-in. So those are the list of high risk roadways that we came up with using that approach. We are going to break out into a session next where we can certainly answer more questions on this, dig further into the tool, and talk about maybe other priorities and potentially ordering some of these in terms of what the town of Yarmouth would like to look at further. So I'll turn it back over to you, Heather.
Great. Thank you, Joe. That was a lot of information and I think very well presented. We definitely want to pause here and see if there are questions about what Joe presented, but also we want to move into the sort of more substantive and feedback portion of our workshop here. So let me make sure that I am in slideshow mode. So, would love to, have a more interactive discussion at this point. We have a number of questions that we'd like to pose to the group and sort of get your feedback on, but would like this to be a bit, rather informal, especially given the size of the group. We had thought that we would potentially split out into breakout groups. There are, I think, only 10 people who are not on the project team. So I think we can manage that in one group and have the benefit of hearing everyone's thoughts. So I hope you gathered from both the presentation that Joe gave and then his orientation to this viewer tool that there are a lot of resources that are available to look at and consider. The tool, I think, is a really user-friendly way of navigating around these different resources that the Woods Hole Group has developed through their modeling and analysis. And we will make that available to everyone to be able to look at after the meeting this evening. So you should feel free to, if you feel like you're not able to process all the information that we're presenting now, take some time over the next few days to look at the tool and investigate the data layers that are presented there. There is a feature that Joe touched on for providing comments directly into the tool, and I'm happy to discuss that in a little bit more detail if people have questions about that. There is some information on the tool itself when you land on the page to help you understand how that works. But what I would like to do now is just sort of set up our conversation for this evening, starting with, is this information a surprise? Are there roads that you are aware of that flood regularly or you've seen inundated during a storm event that aren't represented here? We'd like to try to capture that and make sure that roads that are a problem presently are considered in the group of roads that we're presenting here. And then we'd like to sort of think through, of the roads that are presented as these high priority roads that they meet that test of high risk because they're both vulnerable and they play a critical role in the community's transportation network. How can we prioritize those roads? Are there certain things, values that rise to the top that would help us elevate certain road segments for looking at in more depth and coming up with a solution for? What specific knowledge can you bring to the conversation? So that's the sort of the second thing that we'd like to address. And then where we're tending here is to try to prioritize this list of roads in some fashion, or identify, if not A, B, C, D, identify the top three to five that you as a group would then suggest that the town staff consider as the higher priority road segments to move forward with some design and cost estimates. And just as a reminder, that the funding for this project will allow us to have the Woods Hole Group look at two road segments in the town of Yarmouth and identify three potential solutions for each of those road segments. So ultimately, that's where this project is headed. And those road segments would then be presented to the town. Those three solutions for those road segments would be presented to the town for further consideration to move forward with some engineering and permitting to actually address the problem. So that I will pause there with my overview and just see if there are any initial reactions. Let's start with this first question. Are there roads segments that you're aware of that we've missed that should be part of our larger list here? And feel free to just unmute yourself. I think there are a few people here. It should be manageable. I mean, honestly, in Yarmouth, there's a lot of roads that are going to be vulnerable to flooding. So, and some that seem that if they're not experiencing it yet, they will be soon. So perhaps the modeling has done a good job of capturing the things that people are aware of at the present time. So not hearing anyone sort of chiming in on that, what local knowledge can you bring to this conversation?
Hello, can you hear me? I've never done Zoom before. I have no idea what I'm doing here.
Oh, that's fantastic. Thank you for joining. You look like your iPhone 8. So if you could just tell us who you are.
My name's John Peterson and I live on Wharf Lane in Yarmouthport.
Okay, and great.
So it seems that all of the roads you've identified, you know, prioritized in Joe's presentation are really limited to, you know, South Yarmouth and along Route 28, which I understand, you know, is a really important part of the town. But I don't see anything north of Route 6. And I do live in an area that is colored in somewhat in your maps there on Wharf Lane. And, you know, the road was flooded twice about 3 years ago. I'm sure you recall, we had two, large winter storms, and one in January and one in March. It was either 3 or 4 years, winters ago. Mm-hmm. But anyway, 2018. So, yeah, and I live right at the intersection of Thatcher Shore Road and Wharf Lane. And that section of Wharf Lane was underwater. And another portion of Thatcher Shore Road was underwater. And Mill Lane was underwater in sections. And Water Street was underwater in sections. So I can see that those areas are identified in the map somewhat, but you know, I tuned into this tonight in the hopes that I could draw some attention to where we live at the intersection of Thatcher Shore Road and Wharf Lane, but I just don't know, you know, in terms of like how critical is it for the transportation needs of the town or anything. You know, I'm sure we'd probably be down on the list, but I was hoping to point that out, that, you know, from our, you know, per, you know, speaking just from a personal standpoint, you know, we're really hoping that something could be done down here as well. But I understand, you know, I understand you have to have priorities. And so anyway, that's all I wanted to add. because I didn't see any discussion about anything along, you know, Cape Cod Bayside. So just thought I'd throw that out there. So I will go back to
Don't go away yet, because what I'd like to do actually is, given that you've got some areas that you know are problem areas, maybe we can demonstrate how to use the comment feature in the tool. Joe, if you want to take control of the screen and put up the viewer, then John, you can direct us to these areas that you're aware of. So
yeah, well,
so go ahead, John.
Well, if you can with your pointer, if you can just point out that the intersection at Thatcher Shore Road and Wharf Lane,
right here,
if you can find those.
Yeah, I think that's right.
So anyway, right there. I mean, that intersection was under about 16 inches of water at one point during those two storms, which also happened to flow into my front yard and into my neighbor's yard. So
your point is well taken. It's it's definitely another vulnerable area, and the criticality framework that we apply, we have to apply to the whole region. And so we came up with metrics that we thought were important, but as always, it's a guide and local input is crucial. So we can definitely see that, you know, there is evolving probability here of flooding, and that expands over time. Right. There are less areas on the north side that are vulnerable, both probably because of you know, both elevation and the type of storm that it's getting. But you know, they're still, that doesn't mean that they're any less you know, important. So if we look at the risk scores, those also look like there's some elevated risk in some of these areas as well. It just, when we're making a list, we have to have cutoffs, and there's a range of scores that we're, you know, assessing. But again, as Heather said, the local input is certainly certainly important here. So do you have any other specific comments that you want to make on certain segments here, John? We can turn off.
Well, you know, Mill Lane also was pretty, you know, really heavily impacted in those storms as well. And
the Mill Lane?
Yeah, it goes right along the far left side there, yeah.
Right here.
Yeah, right along the pond. Yeah. And then, and Water Street right up by the wharf, you know, the water came rushing in. So, and there, you know, there are houses all around this area here, which are primarily year-round homes. So very few of them are seasonal. So that's not, you know, another factor I would think that you'd be considering. But that's really all I have to add. I didn't see you talking about anything along, you know, the North Shore here, and
I think that
was my concern.
Just a factor of the metric that we came up with to assess risk, and you know, again, the local knowledge is certainly a factor that we can't get at when we're doing a desktop analysis. So, right. What I'm going to do?
I have photos. If you ever want, I have photos of that intersection of Thatcher Shore and Wharf Lane during those storms. If you'd ever like them, I could probably forward those to you pretty easily.
Yeah, that would be great if you wanted to share them with me. And perhaps there are folks in town hall who would want them as well. But, you know, John, I'm pretty sure that you had emailed me and we had an exchange earlier You can use that same email address to send me any photos.
Okay, will do.
So John, I'm just putting in a comment here for you on Mill Lane. Was that flooding that you saw in 2018, was that less than 6 inches or more than 6 inches?
I think possibly it would have been more than 6 inches, yes. But I didn't get over there quickly enough to see it at the height because I was, you know, at the time I was more concerned about what was happening right in front of my driveway. But, yeah. I got over there later and saw the evidence of it. And I'm certain it was very high because, I mean, you could see where all the water came just rushing across the road. You know, it was so obvious what had happened over there, but I didn't get to see it firsthand, but I know it happened. I'm certain that it happened.
So this is just
you could also see the ice blocks that came in, these large, you
know, remember that?
You know, yeah. Because that very first, that January storm, there was a great deal of ice that came in areas with the, with the flood. And you could see that on the, you could see small icebergs all scattered around as well.
So I started putting in a comment here for you and just stepping through the types of questions that we're asking. I think they're all optional, but if there's anything you want to add to here, I'd be happy to type it in. So it was a road, coastal flooding on a roadway during a storm. It was, more than 6 inches of water.
Much more at our location right here. It was much more than 6 inches.
Is there's also a comment in terms of access to critical infrastructure, whether or not there's a alternative to get around that flooded area.
So there's really not.
Closest road, no alternative. And you would assign it a low, medium, or high priority?
Well, in my mind, it's a high priority, but I think, you know, you'd have to look at it, you know, in the context of the entire town. And I'm sure, unfortunately, it would have to go down on the list, lower down on the list, but I'd like to at least be on the list if possible.
Sure. So I'm gonna submit this comment. And if you want to go into the tool, you can also, basically turn on the coastal flooding comments layer like I have here, or the coastal erosion comments layer, and then go to this edit tab. And then you can select which kind of comment you want to make and drop a dot down. I think you said that your other concern was this intersection here of Wharf Lane and Thatcher's.
Yeah, that's my number one. That's my personal priority right there.
Joe?
Answer all these questions. Go ahead, Martha.
Joe and Heather, I just for the purposes of discussion, I am not a Yarmouth resident. You know, I'm a commission employee, but I head east after work at the end of the day. And I usually use 6A, and I can think of several storms, or at least two storms, where 6A was not passable due to a tree being down or something else during a storm. And the area that John has brought up was part of the kind of alternative route. So I'm just thinking, if that area was flooded out, the area that John's talking about, there would have been no way out. So. Yeah. Just wanted to note sort of the semi-criticality of that area in terms of an alternative route to 6A.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah.
Can I actually jump into about the north?
Yes. I'm sorry, I can't hear you. You're gonna have to speak up, or something's not working quite right. Who is speaking? Is it Ashley?
Is it Ashley?
Yeah, you're muted right now, Ashley. Yeah, try doing that. That works. Okay, so thank you, John, for that, those comments. And I, it, you know, we captured some of that directly in the in this viewer tool. As I noted, this tool is available for anyone to use. We'll be posting it on our low-lying roads website on the webpage on the Cape Cod Commission website. There are, you know, 10 towns that we're working with. We're developing viewers for each one. So you just want to make sure that you're, you know, navigating to the viewer for Yarmouth. But should be fairly straightforward for anyone to add some comments directly to the map. So other thoughts. I mean, I really appreciate John's, you know, the way he presented his concern about this, recognizing that these are more local roads. They're not necessarily through routes, although Martha sort of noted that that neighborhood can be an alternative to Route 6A at times when 6A might be impassable. But these are all, you know, considerations that are important as the town tries to prioritize road segments to go forward with. I thought another interesting point was that this neighborhood is mostly of year-round residents and not so much second homeowners or seasonal residents. And, you know, maybe that should figure into the, you know, the calculus for what parts of town should be prioritized over other parts. Are there other thoughts along those lines? You know, what are some other and please, you know, town staff, other things that you've heard, other things that should, you know, just to sort of get out into this conversation about how to prioritize roads for the community. That looks like Ashley's. Oh yeah, Kathy, go ahead.
Yeah, can you show the list again of what was the prioritized criteria for how some of the locations were shown? Because a lot of the places down near Lewis Bay and Nantucket Sound, they're dead end roads too, and they don't have a lot of necessarily any houses or something. I was just kind of wondering how some of those got chosen. So if we could maybe just see the criteria again, and then maybe take a look. I want to leave it open for anybody who wants to answer some of the questions, but I just thought maybe that would be the next step that we could talk about.
Yeah, I think a great point. I observed that too. There are a lot of dead end roads. I think some of the critical facilities or things that might've been identified as critical facilities could be community resources. And, you know, so then that will automatically elevate that road segment if it has even, you know, at the end of Berry Avenue, you know, the sailing building there. I don't know whether that's, you know, was on our list for critical facilities, but that kind of thing, a community building could elevate a segment.
We had both community facilities and emergency facilities, and emergency facilities carried a higher weight. The other part of this is not just the criticality scoring and how important the roadway is, it's the probability. And sometimes the probability of flooding kind of weighs out everything.
Can you show the list that you had that showed the four different things that you were looking at?
Different criteria.
On the list of the roads, yes.
Your slide with the circle graphic.
You know, where you said you're looking at critical facilities, you're looking at
social vulnerability, emergency services. Yeah.
Yeah, that one. Thank you.
So this doesn't have the details of how the scoring played out, but if an emergency service was present either along the roadway or to the next kind of critical intersection, it received a high score. If it also included, if that roadway also serviced a community facility, which is the left-hand column, it would receive an even higher score. Whereas if it was just one of those community services, it was a not zero, but not high.
So nothing yeah. Like the fact that there's not another way to get to these areas or the number of houses that were being serviced, did that play a role somewhere?
So not being able to get to other areas, we didn't have a road network analysis available. So the best we could do in that regard was using the functional classification from MassDOT. We tried to get at that a little bit if it was for these community and emergency services by going to the next intersection with a higher level roadway. That was really the criteria, was, is there another way to get here to a more bigger roadway, for lack of a better word? So not going into a neighborhood, but rather going to some other connecting street. That would give it a sort of a low, medium to high score based on whether or not it had community or emergency services or both.
Yeah, I know that when we did our MVP and the hazard mitigation plan, we had a lot of things listed in the critical facilities. So I don't know whether, you know, Bayview Beach counts as a critical facility. So it's like, I see that Amanda has her hand up. So I don't know whether she has some more stuff, because I think there's some stuff that has been done at Bayview Beach as well.
Yeah. Amanda, please. Oh, you're muted.
And videoed. That wasn't my intention, but this is Jace. Here's my baby. Working from home. My question more or less was, looking at this framework here, is, you know, are soils or actual physical characteristics taken into consideration too? Kind of like you said, like Bayview Beach obviously is more sandy, so obviously you get experiences the flooding, but you know how you were talking about the longevity of the flooding, you know, that might subside quicker than, you know, some of the glacial till that's up on the north side. And I wasn't sure that was incorporated.
It does not, although that could factor into the residence time for flooding that we could calculate.
Okay.
But it doesn't come into an assessment of how important or critical the road segment is, and it doesn't come into whether or not water is getting there in a storm event. But certainly a relevant consideration if we were to start digging into a certain road segment and there's a difference between different soil types, both from a construction standpoint and from a residence time standpoint. It's a good question.
Right. So unless there are, other questions. Yeah, Rick. Hi, Rick.
Hi, Heather. So has specific to the North Dennis Road area where the Crab Creek culvert lie, I have witnessed two times this year when the water level has been in excess of the top of the culvert there. So it's an area that's a fairly heavily traveled roadway. And
What was the name of it, Rick?
It's the Crab Creek culvert. It's on North Dennis Road. It's the area between Fallen's Pond leading up until Mill Pond.
And that road is...
You're getting warm.
Thought you were going to solve that problem for us, Rick.
We're working on that, but I just wanted to get it added to the list.
Is this over here?
No, keep going. Yeah. Oh. Right there.
Right here.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's a 6-foot square culvert that now the creek leading up to it is 58 feet wide. It was not that long ago, only 18 feet wide because of the increased velocity running through there. So it's, again, there were two occasions this year where I witnessed the water above the top of the culvert. So it's increasing.
And that would be this culvert on.
That's correct.
Mapped as Bass River. Okay.
Municipal group has done a tremendous amount of mapping for us in that area. And if we're able to get some funding, the tie-in bond engineering firm has recommended a 60-foot wide bridge that would certainly relieve some of the problems there, but it's I don't think it's going to go away anytime soon.
Would you say that was the Crab Creek culvert?
That's correct. You know, since the railroad bridge was opened up 65 feet water at low tide and 85 feet at high tide, the amount of water ending up in that part of the river is increased.
The railroad bridge over Bass River.
Correct. Yeah, just replaced with the bike trail bridge now.
Right.
Yeah, it looks like there's definitely, I'm not sure why there's some nodes missing here. It might be because it's a culvert. We have a different data layer that we were looking at for those elements. But I would guess it's somewhere between a 20% and 5% chance. So the elevation is somewhere between 6.5 feet and 5.5 feet in AVD 88. So that's,
great.
Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you, Rick, for that. Kelly, I think you're next.
Hi there. I just had a couple of questions. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Great. So I just wanted to know whether under the economic considerations, whether it includes things like, sources of town revenue, like beach access, those types of things, or is it really just location of businesses, the business community?
Our criteria that we used was purely whether or not there were businesses in the area. So again, another level of local knowledge that could add to the...
Because I guess I kind of think of, there's a lot of those kind of smaller beach access, which is the end of dead end roads, where we do see some, flooding at the ends of those roads. There's like Seagull Road that goes out to Seagull Beach, which may, I don't know whether it's not hitting the criteria because its elevation is maybe a little higher, but I would certainly expect it to be somewhere in there. That's down at, Lewis Pond, down there. So it is hot coming up there as a high probability, but it may be lower priority, but just south of Lewis Pond there.
At the end of Seagull Road?
So Seagull Road, directly below Lewis Pond there, where the words are.
That's kind of
the section where it's got marsh on either side and we have a couple of failed culverts. And
Definitely high probability.
That would be low priority.
The criticality scores were sort of middle of the range to lower end of the range. And that's probably due to a number of factors. Critical facilities, not present, business density, traffic count is... I'm not sure of the ultimate, the total range, but it's also a local road. Mm-hmm. So again, this is a case in which, you know, we can't design the perfect metric.
There's so many considerations.
Yeah.
And I just had a couple of other questions. So you have included private roads, right? That was.
They've been assessed, but they aren't included in like when we're sorting the list for high risk road segments. They're not included because it's not the town's responsibility.
Okay, because I thought Prince Road was on your list, but I thought it was a private road, but maybe I'm
mistaken.
Is it? Either one of those points. I thought I saw it on a list. It's the one that connects out to that little community on Mill Creek.
Yeah, that was Prince. Kathy's shaking her head though.
I had the same concern because it's so isolated, but the assessor's map says it's the town.
Okay, so yeah.
That may not be correct, but.
So we're taking that ownership information directly from the MassDOT road network inventory, which could be right, it could be wrong.
Okay. Yeah, I thought I'd looked it up before and thought that it was private, but I may have been mistaken.
You should be able to download that information from the town's website just to make sure that it's one managed, Joe.
And then just my final question was obviously Route 28 sections come up in this. Is there like a mechanism through this project to have a notification to the state so that this kind of thing is on their radar across the Cape? Or are they doing these type of things themselves to assess their roads that you know?
They are. They have a lot to deal with. So I imagine, you know, if you make your voice heard, you might get a little more attention. We don't have a formal mechanism through this project or a conduit to the state through this project.
Given that we just replaced the Parkers River Bridge, that's not going to be high on anyone's priority for the near future. But
oh, I know. No, but I think that this question comes up often, and I think perhaps a reasonable outcome of this project, in addition to the work to be done. To come up with solutions for road segments would be a list of roads elements that are of significant concern to the Cape community that are under the state's control, and just elevate that. I think that's really important. And Kelly, just back to your comment about the economic elements of some of these roads, and that they are connecting with beaches and or other resources that might not be reflected as business activity, and yet they are really important for the community. I think that's part of what we anticipate going into the town's thought process about prioritizing which road segments to go forward with, because as Joe said, there are only certain kinds of things that we can put through the GIS to come up with this scoring, because there's only so much data available, and then we have this subset of roads that then needs to be informed by local priorities and local interests.
I think another thing to consider when you're thinking about these accesses to beaches, and another thing we've seen, at least in other towns, probably true in Yarmouth too, is boat ramps, naturally low-lying coastal areas that get a lot of use and are certainly vulnerable to storm impacts, probably vulnerable to nuisance flooding over time, which is probably more salient thing to consider, because odds are some of these areas are not going to be used or need to be accessed during a storm. I could be wrong. There might be, emergency services, like a harbor master needs to get to to one of these areas. But there's, I think, some other things to consider, whether or not, during a storm when the flooding is there, whether that needs to be addressed or whether you can wait for the flooding to subside and then go back and do some cleanup.
Right.
Heather. So the difference between, you know, storm access and daily access is another important thing to consider.
Right.
Heather, can you hear me?
Yes. Is it Carl?
This is Carl Von Hone.
Yeah.
Just to add on to some of what's being said, I really wish the boat ramps and the ways down to the waterfront weren't important places during storms. But boy, if you have a boat out in the area that you're concerned about, it becomes very important as those become some of our greatest congested areas during storm events, as well as some of the spots that the general public just congregate to, congesting it even further. I think these maps are very good. Having been out for the last 26 years during the major storm events and seeing what roads are flooding and what ones are not, I think this overlay covers a lot of those areas very accurately. Of course, in recent years, with some of the locations such as Shore Road down by the Lewis Bay area, you know, we're seeing even high tides and moon events overtopping Shore Road. So we're starting to see in some areas, whether it's road layout compression or some of these elevation and tides, we're seeing inundation on a more regular basis. And I'm glad this study captured some of that. That area that you have right there, you know, you do have a good number of homes down there. And as you can see, a good number of them would be completely isolated, you know, given the biggest, a big enough event. I don't disagree with Water Street on the north side or Thatcher. And also don't disagree that if Route 28 gets shut down, those could be some of the roads that would be used for, you know, getting past those obstructions. You know, we have plenty of roads to the south of Route 6A and roads to the north of Route 28 that, you know, we routinely divert traffic to, you know, when we do have an obstruction in one of those major roadways. I think one of the elephants truly in the room is DOT. And Route 28 and Route 6A has a number of spots where we've, you know, seen road inundation during storms. Heck, we had a seal right by Pizza by Evans on Route 6A that came up through the elevated water all the way up to the cranberry bog there and ended up on Route 28. So, you know, we do have areas that people wouldn't necessarily think of becoming inundated. That whole section at the Parkers River Bridge, the other section down by the old trampoline where the town just purchased the three properties right there on Mill Creek, all in vulnerable areas along, you know, the main thoroughfares to bring us to and from the hospital. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we can't just sit back and say, well, that's the state's problem. You know, and mm-hmm. I know in the town of Yarmouth, we are very vocal with the state to the point of sometimes getting sighs when they know it's someone, one of us calling. Mm-hmm. But I have to say, I think these maps are good. I think your chart of the road segments really kind of round up, especially within the percentages of, you know, the likelihood of inundation. Those are some of our lower lying areas in town. I think you did a good job with this, and, you know, we'll see as we start to prioritize where we go and which ones we finally choose. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Carl. Those are good things to have said out loud. Tara, I see you have your hand up.
Hi, yeah, this is, I'm Tara Lewis. I am not a resident of Yarmouth. I'm a Cape Cod Commission staff, but wanted to mention that low-lying road strategies, kind of to Carl's point about alternative strategies, one of them is to increase transportation redundancy and meaning different modes of transportation, including railroads and boats. I know that's not really part of this project per se, but, and also I understand, of course, being on the team project, that there are so many different factors and data and variables that go into this whole criticality scoring. But one thing to Carl's point is that increasing your transportation redundancy by having access to other ways of getting around, especially in cases of emergency, and certainly this would be more post-storm than during storm, but just kind of wanted to point that out. Not sure that it's highly relevant to the conversation, but wanted to make note of it.
Yeah, no, I think that is definitely part of the equation here. All right. Amanda had her hand up at one point, and then maybe she, I don't see her anymore. So, any other thoughts about maybe how to prioritize some of these road segments? I think there have been some good things that have come out of just this discussion so far that, you know, highlight some important local interests beyond what we were able to do in our scoring framework. But Kathy, yeah.
Can you go to the area, the segment C, which is all those little roads that go into the Parkers River Marsh area? Can you identify for me what was the things that were getting ticked there, other than obviously being low? And also, what might you possibly do for something like that as far as options of remedying it? Just to give people an idea, how involved are these types of things to help select an option?
Yeah, sure. So let's first, it's obviously low, and that probably weighs heavily into that risk calculation. but let's look at the criticality. It's sort of middle of the road, EJ, social vulnerability area, no community or emergency services in the immediate vicinity. It did get mapped within one of the business density areas. I think just kind of based on its proximity to 28. So whether there are actually businesses in this little block, probably not.
No.
I didn't develop the business density data layer, but I want to say it was on a block group basis. We'll have to
look back at that.
Commission that staff that did that about that. So that's definitely a factor there is it's getting grouped in with some business corridor. But again, you know, I think what's happening here is really it's a high probability, even in the near term for certain parts of those segments. What you do about it, definitely a tough question when you're looking at 4 to 5 roadways in a fairly dense neighborhood residential setting. Depending on the pattern of flooding that's coming in here, I'm guessing that it's mostly coming from the Parkers River and the marshes. So if there was some opportunity to build up a landscape berm around the edges, you might be able to keep some of that out. The other alternative is really like elevating the road segments, but I'm not sure how much good that would do you right. if roads or people's yards are going to flood anyway.
Exactly.
Unless, you know, there's building level floodproofing and wet and dry floodproofing that could be applied. And so, you know, it might be one of those instances in which you allow an area to flood and just make sure that people are out of the way and that the area can recover afterwards. Could also be some sort of a network of walls and backyards. I mean, that's not ideal, but.
So that one sounds rather challenging and may not be something we
want. Very challenging.
Even if you elevate the roadway itself, then you have to worry about tie-ins to driveways and yards
right.
as well. You don't want to just like build an island.
If you have a nice dip or something, that might be something where raising it, you might be able to make the grades work into the abutting mm-hmm. properties. But this one, I was like, it's all, there's a lot of them if you actually look at that. I mean, even Bayview does that. And you know, going down by the sailing center, they're all just really low. And some areas maybe you can build up, but if all the houses are next to it are lower than the road that you've built up, really, what are you saving?
Right.
Well, and I think that highlights, you know, sort of the other part of sort of some of the hard decisions that everybody in the community needs to face. This particular neighborhood over time may need to think about retreat. You know, some folks may want to hold out and elevate their homes and try to maintain access. But over the long term, retreat may be a better strategy. And so then putting community resources towards addressing roadways probably makes less sense. In places like that. That's my opinion, putting out there.
May be facing nuisance flooding issues and over the term there.
And that's what Seth's telling you, the one that you have? Thank you.
Yeah. So as you said, Kathy, the things like bridges and culverts and other areas that connect to high points but dip down might be easier to address and might make more sense if they're within some sort of a corridor that connects neighborhoods, connects critical services. You know, one that I can think of is up by, I think there's some town facilities. Is there a fire station up this way?
It's on Buck Island, which is further to the north. And that's the new DPW facility as well, right there.
Fire station.
That's now the new DPW.
So this area, I was looking at earlier, it's high enough that it's not vulnerable to nuisance flooding. It's high enough that it's not vulnerable to storm surge in the near term. But as conditions evolve, some vulnerability. The low probability, but it's potentially get a little worse over time. And so if you're concerned with making sure that DPW has access to their facilities during a storm or the fire station can get out and serve the community, then some of these like little dips here might be something to address. Mm. Not now.
Not now, right.
In the future. But if there is a similar situation with current or near-term vulnerabilities, that would be a place to focus.
Can you scooch down to the hospital? I'm just wondering, we only had like one little area. What was the
Where is that?
Yeah. It's actually in Hyannis, right over the line.
Right,
right there. Yeah.
There.
So we don't have, I mean, you know, Carl had a good point. Route 28 is obviously the main corridor for a lot of communities to get to the hospital. Is there any other, is there local roads that are impacted at all, or just that little piece at the very end?
We haven't mapped out Barnstable yet, but I imagine based on what I'm seeing here, there's going to be similar vulnerability in this downtown area.
And Joe, I think if you click on the 2070 probability, you will see that that segment that's down there by the hospital does get more impacted. So it's one of the alternate routes to the back parking lot areas. And depending on what we see in Barnstable, when we do that work, you know, we may find that collectively there are these sort of alternate access points to the hospital are impacted.
So I think that's mostly just the trail around the bar.
Yeah, that squiggly is
right. It looks like this dead ends right here.
That's definitely the roadway around the hospital bog there. Yeah, there you go.
These are the access roads. So here. South.
So I'm just trying to keep note of the time and that we want to try to wrap up by 8. Let people get on with their evenings. But I think this has been a, you know, very interesting conversation for me, and I hope helpful and interesting to the town as town staff considers of the roads that we've identified through the analysis are the high priorities, which ones they might want us to look at in more detail. I don't know if folks have any last comments before we leave the map here, but I'll just, I have one slide to share on next steps so that everyone knows where we're headed. And back over here. There we go. So next steps, just so as I noted, we will we'll compile some of the information that we heard in this workshop and share that with town staff together with that table of actually this table right here that the Woods Hole group has developed from their analysis. And it will be up to town staff to identify 2 road segments that we'll then ask the Woods Hole group and a subcontractor to do some additional work on. They'll conduct a feasibility analysis and identify sort of a range of solutions. We're hoping that there's possibility for a gray solution and a green infrastructure solution, sort of more of a nature-based solution. Certainly there will be some kind of a gray solution, there typically is, but part of the focus of this project is to see if there are more nature-based solutions as well. And what are the costs for those different solutions for those different segments? And then for those who are interested, you know, we'll be sharing that information directly back to our contacts in the town staff, but we'll also be posting those solutions on our webpage for this project, which can be found pretty easily through the Cape Cod Commission website if you just put in low-lying roads project. And someone is suggesting that we put that in the chat, which is a great idea. Maybe one of you all can do that for me so that you then will have that link to our webpage. And that should happen later this spring or perhaps early summer. Our grant for the EDA portion, the towns that are we're doing under the EDA grant need to be finished up by, well, we're looking for an extension, so I'm going to say summertime. But I think that's the time frame to check back in on this project. So any other thoughts or questions that folks have? And if not, I'll just pop out of this and thank everybody for coming and your time and participation. We appreciate it. And again, encourage people who are interested to provide comments either in the tool, explore the tool and add comments there, or send us an email. There's a, my email address is linked on the tool. So you can do it that way too. So with that, I'll thank everybody for participating. Really appreciate your time. Hope you found it worthwhile and look forward to seeing you all again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.